The recent debate between Cardinal Robert McElroy and Bishop Thomas Paprocki brought into the open the growing divide among Catholic bishops. Can there be unity when bishops are following essentially different religions? That's what we're going to talk about today on Crisis Point. Hello, I'm Eric Sammons, your host and editor-in-chief of Crisis Magazine. Before we get started, as always, I just want to encourage you to smash that like button, to subscribe to the channel. Don't hit the notify bell, though, because you do have a life outside of the internet. But if you are on the internet, feel free to follow Crisis Magazine, at Crisis Mag, on Twitter, Facebook, MeWe, Gab, Gitter, I think some other places as well. Wherever you might be, we're probably there as well. Although we're not on TikTok, and we have no plans to be. We're also on Instagram. I never mentioned Instagram because I'm not really on that one. But I know we have an Instagram account. We're going to start adding some more to that one as well. If you are on Instagram, I hear there's a lot of Catholics there. I'm just not one of them. So, okay. So let me get into the topic of today. The big news at least in the American Catholic world last week was the almost open warfare that broke out between Cardinal McElroy of San Diego, who is one of Pope Francis's favorite cardinals. I mean, just him being a cardinal is crazy because he is the bishop of San Diego, which there's never been a cardinal from there, and he was made a cardinal, even though in the hierarchy of the church, San Diego actually comes below Los Angeles, and the Archbishop Gomez of Los Angeles has never been made a cardinal. So he's clearly a favorite of Pope Francis. Well, back in, I think it was like a month ago. Yeah, it was January 24th. He wrote an article for America Magazine, which is where all heresies go to fester and to come out into the open. And it was on radical inclusion for LGBT people, women and others in the Catholic Church. And in this article, basically, under the guise of synodality, under the banner waving a synodality and inclusion, he talks about the fact that how the church should change to be more inclusive. And he explicitly says the Catholic community contains structures and cultures of exclusion. That's his main point, is that exclusion is happening in the Catholic Church and it needs to be more inclusive. And then some examples he gives when he's talking about women. He advocates, for example, for the ordination of women to the diaconate. Now, this has been a somewhat debated topic, particularly under Pope Francis. I would argue that this is impossible because the ordination is reserved to men alone. All orders of ordination, whether it be diaconate, priesthood, or the episcopate, are reserved to men alone. Yes, there were women who were called deacons in the early church of times, but if you actually study the issue, you find that they were not ordained. But Cardinal McElroy calls for their ordination, and mostly for reasons of inclusion, because women somehow, I mean, this is the height of clericalism, let's be honest. The idea that somehow you're not included if you're not a priest or a deacon or a bishop. I'm none of those, and I don't feel excluded. Well, I actually do feel excluded because the Pope seems to want to shut down the mass I go to. But needless to say, it has nothing to do with me not being a member of the clergy. And also, he believes that women permanent deacons would provide critically important ministries, talents, and perspectives. This is always the call of the left, that somehow, unless you are a woman, you cannot understand women or something like that. And while it's true that you might not understand what it means to be a woman, it's not that a priest can give spiritual direction to both men and women. But then he also, so that's one bad thing he talks about. But then he also then explicitly talks about the fact that certain people are excluded. They feel excluded because they're told they should not receive the Eucharist. They cannot receive communion. And specifically, this is people because of their marital status, meaning divorced and remarried, or because of their sexual orientation activity. He says explicitly, sexual orientation / activity. Obviously, nobody is excluded from the Eucharist if they have a same-sex attraction. that alone would not exclude them from the Eucharist. It's a disordered nature, but we all have disordered natures in some way. It's only if they act on, i.e. sexual same-sex activity, that would lead them being excluded from the Eucharist because they would be in a state of mortal sin. But he says this is basically a pastoral issue, not a doctrinal issue, which contradicts 2,000 years of Catholic teaching all the way up to John Paul II, who explicitly stated it. And of course, Benedict XVI would have agreed with that. And basically, though, he specifically says that LGBT women and men in the life of the church should be able to receive the Eucharist, and they should be included. And he argues essentially for saying that same-sex activity is not always gravely immoral, but of course it is. So he drops this bomb and of heresy, let's be honest, of heresy, and a number of bishops, God bless them, do speak out. Archbishop of Aquila of Denver, Bishop Strickland, of course, of Tyler, Texas, and Archbishop Nauman of Kansas City, who explicitly calls it air. So we have a number of bishops who say, you know, this is wrong, McElroy's wrong, which is good, because often bishops don't want to talk against other bishops. It's kind of like the old boys club. It's somewhat like the U.S. Senate, where if you make it as a member of that, you're not going to talk against other people who made it as a member. But then the big news was when Bishop Thomas Paprocki of Illinois, he wrote an article for First Things called Imagining a Heretical Cardinal. And what he does is he kind of, the structure of the article is like a thought experiment. Imagine there was a cardinal who was a heretic. But in the first paragraph, he literally quotes from Cardinal McElroy's piece I've just been talking about. So while it's stated as like this hypothetical, imagine if this was happening, he's quoting McElroy, and he's calling him a heretic, essentially, in this piece. I mean, there's no other way you can really interpret this other than that. And he talks about the fact that how terrible heresy is. It's denying some truth which is to be believed by divine and Catholic faith. And he specifically says if a cardinal were if somebody's a heretic, a true heretic, then they are automatically excommunicated from the church by the very fact of their heresy. Now, let me make an aside here real quick. I think it was Ed Peters on Twitter said this, but I shouldn't like say that for sure because I can't remember now. But I would agree with it. This idea of an automatic excommunication, I think, honestly, needs to be removed from canon law. Because the fact is, in reality, it's almost worthless. Because essentially, you need some type of authority to declare the excommunication for it to have any worth. Yes, perhaps in the eyes of God, you could argue that they're automatically excommunicated. But the fact is, they don't know it. Nobody's going to enforce it. Nobody's going to tell them. And so the whole purpose of excommunication is to be medicinal. It's to basically tell the person, listen, you are in a state that places you outside of the Catholic Church. You need to repent, confess your sins, and return to the church. That's the purpose of excommunication, is to be medicinal. Also, it is to declare to the world that this person is outside the bounds of the Catholic faith. And that's important, too, because of the potential for scandal. Well, automatic excommunication doesn't do either of those things, because if nobody tells them that they're automatically excommunicated, how is it medicinal? They don't even realize it. They don't know it. And if it's not made public by some type of authority in the church, the scandal's still there. So if Pelosi, for example, Nancy Pelosi is automatically excommunicated, well, nobody has stated that. And so it becomes a debatable point. So I actually don't think automatic excommunications are a good idea in canon law. I think they should remove all those and make it where you have to say something in order to, the proper authority has to declare it an excommunication for it to be really, truly there. That being said, Paprocki does mention that a cardinal who is a heretic, the authority over him would need to declare it, even if they're automatically excommunicated, and that would be the Pope. But then he even goes into the thought experiment, what if this heretical cardinal was in the conclave? Is his vote valid? essentially is what he's asking. He doesn't explicitly say that, but does that invalidate the conclave? I mean, let's be honest. We know that the past few conclaves, there have been cardinals who hold heretical views in them. I mean, it's kind of silly to think otherwise. I mean, Cardinal McCarrick has been a member of a few conclaves. And so the question whether or not that invalidates the conclave is for another time. But this was an escalation. Paprocki's action of basically declaring McElroy heretic was a real escalation in what's been a simmering battle between the bishops. And what I thought was interesting is that the left in the Catholic world, the left Catholics, they freaked out about this. I mean, they freaked out about the fact that Paprocki had dared use the H word, heretic. He dared to say heretic. Now, remember, these are the same men and women who will throw out the word schismatic at anybody who doesn't fall lockstep into every single thing they think we should believe, who doesn't fall lockstep and agree with every single decision that Pope Francis makes. You're schismatic, or you at least have a schismatic mentality. But these same people would argue that even suggesting somebody might be a heretic is beyond the pale. I saw some people talk about how it was disrespectful. It was not having a respectful conversation when you use the word heretic. Yet they'll call anybody and everybody a schismatic. That somehow is acceptable. And this really is something, another kind of an aside here that I think is important. The difference and the importance of schism and heresy, these are two realities that have always existed in the church. Schism and heresy. Two ways in which you break communion with the Catholic Church is through schism or heresy. And it's always been somewhat of a balancing act in the Catholic Church of allowing a certain amount of leeway in what people believe in order that you're not causing schism. And in fact, if you look historically in the Catholic Church has always been leans more towards being tolerant of heresy, for the lack of a better term, tolerant of heresy in order to avoid schism, whereas the Orthodox Church has been much more tolerant of a schism so you don't allow heresy. That's why you see Orthodox churches are going to schism with each other like every other week, because they believe that heresy would be the greater evil. Now, the truth is they're both evil, and they're really equally evil, because both of them, like I said, they break communion with the Catholic Church, which is a horrific thing to happen. So in today's world, what we notice, though, is that Orthodox Catholics, the Catholics on the right, for lack of a better term, they're very concerned about heresy. They argue against the people teaching things that are wrong, and they talk about that a lot. Whereas Catholics on the left, they're much more worried about schism. And so why is that? Why is it that the left will call people schismatic left and right, and people on the right will usually call people heretics somewhat easily, maybe too easily at times? It's because in the left, and when I talk about the left, I'm talking about people like Cardinal McElroy, people like, I'm forgetting the name, some of these left Catholics on Twitter who like to talk about these various things. But essentially, the left sees the Catholic Church is almost like a social club. That the most important thing is we keep this institution and we use it for what they would say is for the good. And so typically that's whatever the modern man thinks is good. That's what they would say is good. So they don't want schism, but they don't care anything about heresy because it's just a social club. So who cares? It's the Anglican Church, essentially, is what they want it to be formed after, where people can believe different things, radically different things, but we're all part of one church. That is essentially the liberal Catholic view of religion, of Catholicism. Whereas on the right, conservative Catholics are much more concerned about the truth, that the Catholic Church is here for a purpose, and the purpose is to teach the truth and to lead people to the truth. And so we can't just have tons of everybody. It's not a big tent, in other words. The Catholic Church is not a big tent. It is true that every single person on earth is invited and urged to become a member of the Catholic Church. But that membership has certain right, has certain obligations. The left would just talk about the rights of Catholics, whereas the left would talk about, the right would talk about the obligations of Catholics. That if you are going to be a member of the Catholic Church, you have to believe certain things, you have to practice certain things, or else you're no longer a member. You're outside of the bounds of the Catholic Church. And so it's not the worst thing in the world that somebody is no longer, feels excluded from the Catholic Church. The fact is, if you reject what the Catholic Church teaches, you are excluded from the Catholic Church. We pray that you repent and that you come to accept it, but you are excluded. So this idea of radical inclusion is radically stupid because it's not Catholic, that's for sure. And so what we see here is this divide that's growing among the Catholic bishops, which of course reflects the divide among Catholics. The reality is that it represents two different religions. Two different religions. Now, I have said this before on Twitter about two different religions within the Catholic Church, and people freak out because they're like, basically, that makes no sense because Catholicism is a religion. How can you say it's two different religions within Catholicism? I'm talking about generally what the term religion means. I mean, if you look up the definition of religion in like Webster's, it says a personal set or institutionalized system of religious attitudes, beliefs, and practices. So it's essentially a system of religious attitudes, beliefs, and practices. Now, who wouldn't argue that Cardinal McElroy has a different system of religious attitudes, beliefs, and practices than Bishop Paprocki? This is actually another aside. This is actually why so many leaders in the Catholic Church want to shut down the traditional Latin Mass, because to them it represents a different religion, a different system of religious attitudes, beliefs, and practices, which it does in a lot of ways. And so it's not about the liturgy as much as it is about within the Catholic Church, what they would see as a different system of religious beliefs and practices. Cardinal McElroy's religion, which he calls Catholicism, and which he is a member of the external Catholic Church, is a religion of modern man. It's basically a religion that grabs whatever the most recent modern obsession is, whether it be abortion or homosexuality, transgenderism, women's rights, racism, whatever the case may be, it grabs that and it makes it its own. If modern man is concerned about something, then that's what the Catholic Church needs. That's what his religion, McElroy's religion, needs to be concerned about. So if a dude who's pretending to be a woman feels excluded, the most important thing the Catholic Church can do is to accept that dude who thinks he's a woman, not challenge him at all, and allow him to live his lie within the bounds of the Catholic Church. That's the religion of McElroy. There's no such thing as universal truth in this religion. Therefore, there's no such thing as heresy. That's why they freak out when you use the word heresy about them, because there's no universal truths to them. Any truth can change. If the truth that a man is a man and a woman is a woman can be jettisoned, well, then all truths are up for debate. It's whatever modern man wants it to be. That's what they're going to accept as true, is whatever we say is true today. It might be a lie tomorrow, but it's true today, and that's what matters. The name of this religion, they call it Catholicism, but it's really the name they're really using lately is synodality. You see that in McElroy's article. He talks so much about synodality, and you see that from Pope Francis and so many other bishops and cardinals. They talk about synodality. They use that term more than they use Catholicism. It's all about synodality. That's the name of this other religion that exists within the Catholic Church. And its number one doctrine is inclusion, as McElroy makes clear. Its number one doctrine is not the Trinity. It's not the divinity of Christ. It's not moral truths or anything like that. It's inclusion. That's the most important doctrine. Everything else is subservient to that. And so they want to remake Catholicism into the image of their religion, what they believe. Now, Bishop Paprocki, on the other hand, he represents a religion of God, that there is a lawmaker, there is a truth maker, so to speak, above man. Man is not the ultimate decider of what is true and what is false. God is. Certain truths transcend modern beliefs, modern fads. And so Catholicism isn't looked upon as something that must adapt to modern man, but Catholicism is instead the answer to modern man's problems. The truth matters. And so, yes, somebody can be a heretic. And that's a very dangerous thing. It needs to be called out. And so even if it can potentially lead to the idea of a schism, a breakup between bishops, that is actually something that is acceptable on one level if the alternative is heresy running rampant within the Catholic Church. And so we see these are radically two different ways, radically two different sets of religious beliefs and practices and attitudes. Radically different. It's two different religions existing within one Catholic Church. And because of that, because they're different religions, it takes a religious conversion to move from one to the other. And this is where I feel like so many Catholics fail. They think a reasonable discussion will lead to everybody agreeing. That's not the case. If I have a discussion, for example, with a Muslim, and we just talk about, here's what I believe, there's what you believe, here's why I think you're wrong, here's why you think I'm wrong, and we just talk about it, that's not going to lead to a conversion. You have to tell the person, in this case, for example, the Muslim, you are wrong, and God himself is calling you to leave your false religion and become Catholic. Your salvation depends upon it. You need a conversion for this to happen. And so likewise, the people who believe in McElroy's religion, the religion of so many of these leftist Catholics, it's a false religion. They need to be converted from it. And so that's why words like heresy do need to be thrown around, because it's a way to make it clear how serious this is. This isn't just an intellectual debate. You might think this, I think that. But instead, this is the salvation of souls matter. And that's why you have to use loaded words, important words like heresy. Reason alone isn't going to bring about conversion. Action is. This is why heretics, somebody who's a heretic, does need to be told, if you do not repent, you will be excommunicated. Again, excommunication is medicinal. It's to tell them, to make it very clear to them, the gravity of what they're doing. Now, here's the problem, though. The problem is that so many of the quote-unquote good bishops, like Paprocki, like even Strickland, like Nauman, like Aquila, they often have the same bad foundations as the bad bishops. I mean, God bless them. We need to support them. But the fact is that they often have some of the same bad foundations. What do I mean by that? What I mean by that is they also look to Vatican II as a super council, not just one of 21 councils, but instead the council which interprets all of tradition. You can see this in their writings. They talk about Vatican II in similar high praise. Now, they think it should be interpreted differently, but ultimately they do see Vatican II as a super council that kind of speaks beyond the other councils. They don't go, you'll notice when they quote things, they're not quoting Trent, for example. They're often not, and they're not quoting popes from before Vatican II. It's always quoting everything from post-Vatican II and Vatican II itself. They fall into the trap of wanting to adapt to modern man. To basically, they want to be acceptable to modern man. And you see this in the fact that they won't go too far. And this is actually reflected in the fact that they took so long to actually use the word heresy. And in fact, disappointingly, Bishop Paprocki actually backed off of his article a little bit. When he was interviewed by the Pillar, he said, well, It was a hypothetical situation. Yes, I quoted McElroy, but I didn't say his name on purpose because I'm not accusing him of being a heretic. I'm just talking about a hypothetical situation if a cardinal was a heretic. Well, that's weasel words. That's backing down, and he shouldn't have backed down. He should have actually said, yes, Cardinal McElroy is saying heretical things, and therefore the authority of the church should ask him to recant those views or be excommunicated. That's actually what they should say. But because of the bad foundations of so many, even the good guys in the church, priests and bishops, and this is because this harkens back to the seminary formation usually. The seminary formation often was like, we're not going to be unorthodox, we're not going to be heretical, but we're going to accept a lot of the assumptions, the false assumptions of modernism, to be honest. They don't really embrace the totality of the Catholic tradition. And often they're also ultramontanist. They also embrace the idea that if the Pope says something, it must be true. And because the Pope is on the side of people like McElroy, they're going to be a lot slower to say anything against somebody like that because they feel like that's somehow going against the Pope and therefore going against Catholicism. Of course, a true understanding of papal authority and the role of the Pope, if they had that, they wouldn't be like that. They would understand that you don't have to agree with every single thing that the Pope says. And so this is the reason why, while I'm happy that Paprocki did what he did, I'm not happy that he backed down from it a little bit. I'm happy that he wrote the article he did. I'm not optimistic that the current crop of bishops, even the good ones, will really be able to withstand the radical push towards heresy by people like Cardinal McElroy, Cardinal Supich, people like that. Because I just don't think, it's not that they don't have the backbone. I mean, I think a lot of them don't have the backbone. I think it's more that they just don't really have a deeper understanding of Catholicism, frankly, and their role as bishops, what they need to do in these situations. The other reason I'm not super optimistic going forward is because of the fact that the vast majority of bishops don't care. I mean, we've had a handful that have spoken up, but most bishops are keeping their heads down. They don't want anything to do with this debate. They might have personal feelings one way or the other, but they're just staying out of it because they're administrators first and foremost. They don't consider themselves successors of the apostles who are bound to preach and teach the gospel to everybody. Instead, they see themselves more as administrators who are supposed to keep the trains running on time, make sure the parishes are still running, that money is flowing and things of that nature. And so I don't see them. Most of the bishops aren't going to say anything. And the few that do often don't have the greatest foundations themselves, theological foundations themselves. Now, that being said, I hate to end on a down note, but I'm kind of leaning towards that. I realize I do think, though, we need to pray and fast for our bishops, obviously, but we also need to encourage bishops like Bishop Paprocki. He is doing more than most of them, and I admire the fact that he was willing to step out because you know he's getting hammered by a lot of people in his diocese, but also from other diocese, other bishops, and from the Vatican itself. And so he's also the one who's done an excellent job of keeping the traditional Latin Mass being said in his diocese by working around canon law and figuring out ways to do that. So I don't want to make it sound like I'm criticizing Bishop Paprocki as much as I'm just saying we need to go further. The bishops need to go further than they are. They've taken too long already. I mean, there should have been bishops decades ago talking about heretics in their midst, and we didn't have that. And it took till 2023, 50 years after it started probably, to finally have a bishop utter the H word about another bishop. So we need to just to continue to encourage them. Don't rail on Paprocki to him or anything like that, but instead encourage him and say, yes, thank you for speaking out. This is helping souls. Thank you for being a good shepherd. I think that's what we need to do while we're praying and fasting for them, of course. Okay, well, let's continue as lay Catholics, most of us are, or priests who aren't bishops, to pray for our bishops, to fast for them, to encourage the good ones, to confront and call out the bad ones, and pray that more of the good ones will take a stronger stand and that future bishops, we should be praying. Here's something that our, you know, our priests at our parish always say, like, you should be praying for our bishop, the local ordinary, but you should also be praying for the next one. Pray that the next person who comes in will be a good bishop as well. Pray for them to be well-formed now and to develop into good bishops one day, because they will be over you at some point. So let's do that. Let's encourage each other to do that. Encourage the good bishops and call out the bad ones. Okay, well, that's it for now. Until next time, everybody, God love you.